please sign up for that if you'd like to take that interesting journey. Also, next Sunday is our Pastor's Reflection Sunday. You should have got an envelope in the mail by now. Your contributions will make this article in the American Press that runs every Thursday by Brother Weldon possible. So please pray about that and be generous with that. It reaches out to so many people. Also, our financial peace class starts next Sunday. We have a lot going on next Sunday. February the 9th, 2:30 to 3:30 in Paxton Hall, and it runs through April the 5th. So you can sign up for that still back here at the Welcome Center. Again, we want to welcome you here this morning. Let's prepare now to worship our Lord.
Invitation found in your order of worship. We have come here today to witness and understand. Let our worship reflect God's light shining within us. Let us pray together. Almighty and gracious God, in your light may we see life clearly. And in your service, find perfect freedom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. February is Cokesbury Hymn Month here at First Methodist, so we're singing old-fashioned hymns out of the Cokesbury hymnal there on our bulletin insert. The first one is The Church in the Wildwood.
Church in the valley by the wildwood, no love we are spotted.
hear the invitation to Holy Communion. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sins, and who seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The peace of God be with you. Let's greet one another in Christian love. You do this every month. We have to stay standing for this next hymn. It's not like it's something new, because we're going to be seated for the scripture reading for today. Tell It to Jesus from the yellow insert.
Be seated. Our first reading is from Psalm 119, verses 105 through 109. Your word is a lamp for my feet, a light on my path. I have taken an oath and confirmed it, that I will follow your righteous laws. I have suffered much. Preserve my life, Lord, according to your word. Accept, Lord, the willing praise of my mouth, and teach me your laws. Though I constantly take my life in my hands, I will not forget your law. Our second reading is from 2 Timothy, chapter 3, verses 16 through 17. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I want to give a special welcome this morning to my good friend, Reverend Stephen Spurlock, and his wife, Jackie. So glad to have you all today. As you know, Reverend Spurlock was a pastor of this church for many years and also served as the district superintendent of the Lake Charles District. And he's the guy who arranged for me to come here in 2010, and I'm always very thankful and appreciative to Stephen and the bishop for that. So welcome to the two of them. Let's do a quick Super Bowl vote. I'm going to give you four options, all right, of what you can vote for. You can vote for the Kansas City Chiefs, the 49ers, the Kitty Bowl. You know they have a Kitty Bowl today? Or I don't care. Those are your four options. At the earlier service, the Kansas City Chiefs won, closely followed by I don't care. So who votes for the Kansas City Chiefs this morning? Okay. Who's voting for the 49ers? Who's voting for the Kitty Bowl? Who's voting for I don't care? I don't care. When's the vote today? I heard a good story that's been told for preachers for a long time, but I'll like it, about an old-time preacher. He told his congregation one Sunday morning that he was going to be preaching the next Sunday on the topic of Noah and the flood. Well, some kids in the church got this idea in their head that they were going to really mess things up a little bit. So the Saturday before that Sunday, they came into the church, and they walked up to the pulpit of the church, and they found the pastor's Bible. And they glued two pages of his Bible together. So the next morning when the pastor got up to preach, he read from the Bible, and Noah took for himself a wife, and she was, and then he turned the page and he kept on reading, 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. Well, the pastor paused for a second, and then he read the passage once again to himself, and he shook his head. And he finally turned to the congregation and he said, you know, I've been reading this Bible for almost 50 years and I've trusted it completely, but there are some things that are just difficult to understand. Our series of sermons is on challenging questions in a skeptical age. Our focus so far has been on how can I believe in a God that I can't prove? Why is there suffering and evil? Did the resurrection of Jesus really happen? Is Christ the only way to heaven? And now this morning, the question, how can I trust the Bible? You know, the Bible's the number one bestseller in the history of the world. It's been translated into over 2,000 different languages. It's an old book, but can we trust it even though it's an old book? Can we trust it? A man by the name of Josh McDowell is an outstanding writer in the area of Christian apologetics. I've read and enjoyed a lot of his books over the years. In one of his books, he talks about giving a lecture in a history class one day at a large university. He said to the history class, he had like 100 students in the class, he said to them that day that there was more evidence for the accuracy and the reliability of the New Testament than for any other classical literature in all of history. Well, as he was speaking that day, he could see the young professor kind of standing on the side of the room, laughing a little bit to himself, as if to say, come on, nobody believes that. So Josh McDowell stopped, and he turned to the professor, and he asked him what he thought was funny about that. And the professor said, I can't believe that you have the audacity to stand here in a history class at the university and to claim that the New Testament is reliable. That is ridiculous. Well, Josh wanted to have a decent conversation about this, so he asked the professor a question. He said, tell me, sir, as a historian, What are the tests that you personally apply to any piece of historical writing to see if it's accurate and verifiable? Well, amazingly, the young professor didn't have an answer. So Josh McDowell then told the professor that he always personally applied three standards to test the accuracy and the reliability of any ancient document, including scripture. Here are the three tests: a bibliographical test, the internal evidence test, and the external evidence test. So this morning, in considering our question for today as to whether we can trust the Bible, I want us to apply those three important tests to the New Testament. First of all, consider the bibliographical test. Now, don't let that big word turn you off, because it's the test of historical writings, and it's so important. The purpose of that test is to figure out the answer to this question: does the Bible that we have today, that we hold in our hands today, actually conform to the original documents? Has the Bible changed over the years? The most important thing in this area to find out is this: how many old manuscripts exist? How many handwritten copies do we have that were made before the printing press came about? Now, I'm talking about actual manuscripts that we can see and hold and examine. That's how it's done. The accuracy of an old document is verified based on the number of manuscripts that we still have today. For example, think about Plato. Every scholar today accepts the writings of Plato as being accurate. But all we have today is seven manuscripts from Plato. That's all, seven of them. I took a class in college called The Rhetoric of Aristotle. Today, only 49 of Aristotle's manuscripts are in existence. Think about Homer's Iliad, which, by the way, is the second best documented writing of ancient times. Guess how many copies we have of that? 643 copies of his manuscripts are in existence. But when it comes to the New Testament, it's a completely different story. Today, in existence are over 5,300 copies of the New Testament in the original Greek, over 10,000 copies in Latin, over 9,300 portions of the New Testament. So that means that we have over 24,000 manuscripts of the New Testament in existence today. Over 24,000. That is unheard of. Bruce Metzger has written 50 books about the authority of the New Testament based on all these old manuscripts. Here's what he said about this: the quantity of New Testament material is almost embarrassing in comparison with other works of antiquity. I want to say it again so that it's very clear to every person in this sanctuary today. The New Testament has greater manuscript authority than any other ancient piece of writing in the ancient world. It's not even close. 24,000 manuscripts compared to 697. That's the first test, the bibliographical test. The second test is the internal evidence test. It asks the question, is it credible? Can it be believed? To what extent is it credible? It's asking, is it believable? I'm quoting now from Josh McDowell's book. He writes this: this ability to tell the truth is closely related to the witness's nearness, both geographically and chronologically, to the events recorded. The New Testament accounts of the life and teaching of Jesus are recorded by men who had either been eyewitnesses themselves or who had passed along the accounts of eyewitnesses of the actual events or the teachings of Jesus. I want us to hear these statements from the New Testament. I'm going to read several for us today. Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Luke said, "Many people have done their best to write a report about the things that have taken place among us. They use the eyewitness report circulating among us from the early disciples." And then he said, "Having carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I also have decided to write a careful account. I'm doing this so that you will know the full truth about everything that you were taught." 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16. Here's what Simon Peter said. We were not making up clever stories when we told you about the powerful coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. With our own eyes, we saw his greatness. We were there. 1 John chapter 1, verse 3. We proclaim to you what we ourselves have actually seen and heard. John chapter 19, verse 35. This report is from an eyewitness giving an accurate account. He speaks the truth so that you also can believe. And then Acts chapter 4, verse 20. We cannot stop telling about everything that we have seen and that we have heard. I'll say it again. The writers of the New Testament were eyewitnesses, or they talked to people who were eyewitnesses. To me, it certainly passes the internal evidence test. What they say is credible. It's believable. The third test of an ancient writing is the external test, the bibliographical test, the internal evidence test, and the external evidence test. It all goes back to this important question. Does history verify what's written there? Does archaeology back up the claims or contradict it? That's the question. Now, here's the answer. To me, it's pretty simple. Archaeology backs up the Bible over and over again. Some of the places of the New Testament that have been verified by archaeological discoveries include the town of Bethany, Bethlehem, Bethesda, Caesarea, Cana, Capernaum, Emmaus, Jericho, Jerusalem, and all over Jerusalem, Nazareth, and Sychar. In fact, over 25,000 sites have been discovered that are pertinent to the Bible. Over 25,000 archaeological sites. Dr. Nelson Gluick was an American rabbi and teacher. An archaeologist. He was the president of the Hebrew Union College from 1947 until the early 1970s. And his hard work of biblical archaeology actually discovered over 1,500 biblical sites. Here's what he said about this, and note carefully what this guy says. No archaeological discovery has ever contradicted a biblical reference. Scores of archaeological findings have been made which confirm in clear outline or in exact detail historical statements in the Bible. I want us to hear that first sentence again. He said, no archaeological discovery has ever overturned anything in the Bible. Christianity is based on history. A man by the name of Gary Habermas is a good historian. He wrote a book that's called The Historical Jesus. In that book, he made a list of 39 ancient sources outside of the Bible that give us over 100 facts about the life and the teachings and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Our faith is based on history. The bibliographical test, the internal evidence test, and the external test, they all point to the fact that Scripture can be trusted. Personally, I love the writings of C.S. Lewis. When he was a young man, he was a strong and a vocal atheist at Oxford University in England. But then one day, a good friend of his pulled him aside, a friend that he really respected, and he told C.S. Lewis that he believed that the Gospels appeared to him to be surprisingly sound. Well, that really caused C.S. Lewis to start thinking. He'd always believed that the Bible was a bunch of legends and stories and just myths, that it had no history behind it. And so to his credit, C.S. Lewis, who was an open-minded atheist, started his own personal investigation. Here's what he did. He carefully read the entire New Testament in the original Greek. And as he did that, he was so surprised at what he found. And don't forget that he was a professor at Oxford of English literature. He had spent his whole life studying ancient manuscripts. I want us to hear a couple of statements from C.S. Lewis about the Gospels. He wrote, "The Gospels appear to be simple eyewitness accounts of historical events, primarily by Jews who were clearly unfamiliar with the great myths of the pagan world around them. He concluded by saying, "As a literary historian, I am perfectly convinced that whatever else the Gospels are, they are not legends. I have read a great deal about legends and myth, and I'm quite certain that they are not the same sort of thing." So after making this great discovery and actually believing that the Bible can be trustworthy, C.S. Lewis gave his life to Christ. Consider somebody else. Her name is Anne Rice. You've heard of Anne Rice before? She's a contemporary writer. She's from New Orleans. She wrote the second best vampire novel of all time, in my opinion, Interview with a Vampire. The best one, of course, goes back to the year 1897, simply called Dracula. I'm going to test you now. Who wrote Dracula? Man, I'm so impressed. I hear a bunch of you say it. Bram Stoker wrote it in 1897, but her novel is a really good vampire novel. Now, back in her college years, she rejected the church. She was brought up in the church, but she rejected the church and Christian teaching, and she declared herself to be an atheist. She lost her faith. But then in 1988, she surprised her fans all over the world by announcing publicly that she was going back to her Christian faith. She was returning to her Christian faith. And here's the reason why. Anne Rice decided that she was going to personally investigate and research the life of Christ. And I'm quoting now. Anne Rice then applied her considerable talents to intensely studying the Bible and theology, and eventually, as C.S. Lewis had done, she then came to the conclusion that the Gospels were historically accurate and, in fact, true, and she gave her life to the Lord. Our question for today is this: can we trust the Bible? The Apostle Paul just puts it like this: all Scripture is inspired by God. God is the one who inspired this book. God is the one who protected this book. It's the most amazing book in the world. It's a book of poetry and prophecy and letters and songs and genealogy and parables and stories and theology and eyewitness accounts of the life of Christ. The famous writer Charles Dickens called the New Testament the very best book that ever was or ever will be known in the world. Abraham Lincoln once said, "The Bible is the best gift that God has given to man." Kirk Cousins, you heard of him? He was the quarterback for the Minnesota Vikings. He posted on his Twitter account this past week, "It took me over 2 years, but I just finished reading the entire Bible for the first time. Definitely recommend it." This is God's word. It's so awesome and so deep that we can spend a whole lifetime reading and studying it and not even begin to understand it. It's so awesome that a child can read it for the first time and God will speak to his soul that very day in that moment. Here's what John Wesley, the founder of our church, said. He said, "I want to know one thing, the way to heaven, how to land on that happy shore. God himself has written it down in a book." And then John Wesley said, "Oh, give me that book." That's my prayer too. Give me that book. It's God's incredible gift to all of us, the Word of God, in happy times and in sad times, in the good times and the bad, every single day. Give me the book that we can trust. Jesus said, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away." Let us pray. Lord, thank you for giving us a book of truth, a book that you have inspired. Lord, help us to be faithful in reading that book and making your word an important part of our lives. Thank you, Lord, that we can read it and trust it and rely upon it. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And now we affirm our faith together through the words of the Apostles' Creed found in your order of worship. Let us stand as we do so. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Bless this offering, that the word of God might be spread in this community and around the world. Amen. Please be seated.
Oh,
Please be seated. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, for the mountains were brought forth and you had formed the earth. From everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who were oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when God would save his people. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, God gave birth to the church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Confidence of children of God, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This day we are thankful for the body of Christ, which is broken for us. And we are thankful for the blood of Christ, which is poured out for us. The Lord's table is now prepared, and the invitation for Holy Communion is for everybody in this sanctuary today. In the United Methodist Church, we believe in an open table, and that means everyone is invited to this sacrament. You don't have to be United Methodist. You don't have to be a member of this church. Anyone who wants to know the Lord and follow the Lord is invited to the Lord's table for this sacrament. I'm going to ask those who are serving to please come first, and then you come as the ushers direct following the choir.